Good afternoon, and welcome to Psychologically Speaking Broadcast, where for the next hour, we will offer continuous conscious conversations on today's topic, which is relevance of the crisis intervention team in law enforcement. I am your host, Dr. Karen Ardwin, and once again, thank each of you all for joining us today. I'm an instructor in our Behavioral Science Division, and on behalf of our Division Chief Joe Aguirre, our branch chief, Walter Burns, and the entire Behavioral Science Division, we want to welcome you and thank you for joining us today. I also want to take an opportunity to welcome our guest speaker, Pat Stroh. Pat, thank you so much for being with us today.
Thank you for having me. It's an honor.
Yes, indeed. I'm actually going to more formally introduce Pat in a little bit, but as we're still allowing our participants a chance to join in and log in, I want to take a moment just to share information about this online platform. Psychologically Speaking is an extension of our Mental Health Crisis Instructor Training Program, which is designed to provide continuous learning for first responders at the local, state, and the federal level, as well as those in the mental health field. In addition, every Thursday of the month, this platform will highlight academic research, law enforcement data, as well as best practices that will better serve those who come in contact with persons with mental illness. In addition to the first Thursday of the month, every month, we will introduce or address mental illness-related materials that will better serve and better help those and equip those who will encounter or interact with persons with mental illness or that are in a mental health crisis. So once again, welcome to our broadcast and so glad to have you here. As the participants are joining us, we have participants that are coming in from across the country, from various agencies and organizations. And we want to invite you to take the time throughout the presentation to ask questions to our presenter. If you notice in our chat box, if you would just put the name of your agency or organization and write your question. We are actually monitoring our chat box and will be able to answer your question. Provide your question to our presenter so that she may answer them for you. So please, throughout the presentation, if you have questions, please feel free to ask. Once again, our presenter for today is Pat Stroh, and Pat is with the Georgia Public Safety Training Center, where she serves as a crisis intervention team advocate. Pat, again, on behalf of the entire Flexi organization, we are so glad to have you here today. Thank you for being here.
Thank you. Again, I am very honored. I'd like to thank Flexi and in particular the Behavioral Science Division for having me out. It is an honor to be able to be here to share with you and the audience today.
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you. And again, she is actually our inaugural speaker, our very first speaker. And so we are very privileged and honored to have you come down and being here with us.
No pressure.
No pressure at all. Just enjoying conversation today that we will have. And hopefully you will become involved by asking those questions in our chat box so that we can present them to our speaker. I actually want to give you a little more information about Pat. She has amazing work history and amazing experiences working with CIT. She worked for the Georgia chapter of the National Alliance on Mental Illness as a crisis and intervention team program administrator. In 2017, she served on the Governor's Law Enforcement Commission addressing law enforcement training. She is a past member of the Crisis Intervention Team International Board of Directors, where she served as secretary. Pat is also a Georgia Peace Officer in Standards Training post-certified instructor. She's an adult mental health first aid instructor, and she's with the National Alliance on Mental Illness as a family-to-family instructor. Wow, that's a lot. You've done a lot involving CIT. Can you tell us a little bit of how you got started in CIT?
Well, I got started as being a member of NAMI and doing some of the programs there. We have been trying to get CIT for years. I started with NAMI in the mid-90s, and that's when we learned, it was about 97, we learned about CIT. And I became a member of NAMI because I have an adult daughter who at the time was, you know, very young, who had just recently been diagnosed with mental illness. I knew nothing. It was terrifying.
Wow.
And so NAMI was the first place, first platform where I learned about her diagnoses, learned about some tips on how to assist her, learned things about self-care that still still learning that. Hard one to learn. But learned about what to do, what not to do, things to say. And when we learned about CIT, you know, certainly wanted to be a part of that. As an advocate, our role with trying to get CIT to Georgia was so that law enforcement officers could recognize our loved ones that have mental illness, yes, and of course not to use force and to get them connected to care.
Yes.
That was a hard sell initially, but we finally got the right audience. At that time, there was the director of the GBI, and we're talking early 2000s, Director Vernon Keenan, saw it not just as an opportunity to assist people with mental illness, he saw it more as a public safety issue.
Right.
Because a good bit of the use of force incidents that GBI investigated involved law enforcement and folks that had mental illness. And sometimes those that were injured were also law enforcement officers. So he saw it as a public safety issue. And so when you put those two together, and then we got CIT in Georgia, and we, of course, 9/11 happened, and so everything was put on hold. And then in 2004, we started it right out. It's been amazing. And as an advocate, I certainly wanted to be a part of that. It was frightening at first,
right.
being in a room with law enforcement, but it's been a joy.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's really impressive, number one, the reason you got involved. But can you share with us the history of CIT and its philosophy?
Absolutely. CIT started in Memphis, Tennessee, in the mid to late 80s, following a fatal shooting of an individual who had schizophrenia there. And of course, when there is sometimes excessive force or the perception of excessive force in communities, there's a community outcry. So it was in Memphis, and that community outcry was led by NAMI. And at that time, it was called the National Alliance for the Mentally Ill, which you know, since changed the name. And so NAMI and other community stakeholders were just outraged and went, of course, to the mayor. And so what do you think the mayor did? He contacted the chief of police and said, you got to do something to address this. The chief of police contacted his training officer. At the time, it was Lieutenant Sam Cochran, who is now retired Major Sam Cochran. And Sam tells the story that when the chief asked him to, you know, get with community and help to develop something, that when he had that first meeting with the community, they were saying, you need to train your officers on how to deal with people with mental illness. And Sam says, well, we thought we had a pretty robust training already. I can't remember whether it was 16 or 18 hours, but he felt that they were doing a pretty good job. But he said, once I got in the room with those advocates and mental health providers and other folks from the community, faith community, we learned that we were not, what we were offering was not adequate to address the current needs. And so the Memphis Model CIT program was born there. And so that's kind of the genesis of it. And it is the standard for CIT.
Can you share with us, because CIT, of course, crisis intervention teams, it has some core elements of what it represents when we say CIT. Can you talk about what that team concept is or the elements that are involved in CIT?
Sure, I will cover some of those for you. So I'm glad you mentioned crisis intervention team. Oftentimes that T is mistaken for training. Training is important, but training alone will not address the issues that the initial CIT programs sought to address. So some of those core components, number one is to identify community stakeholders across the board, folks in the community that can help address the issues of mental health, folks in the community that can help as volunteer instructors. And by volunteer instructors, typically that is clinicians who have training. We consider them subject matter experts who can come in and teach some of those clinical blocks, because law enforcement may have knowledge of some of those, but oftentimes are not able to answer the questions. And quite frankly, in my opinion, should not be instructing those, because they're not the subject matter experts, and they cannot provide that connect with those subject matter experts. So convening stakeholders, that's really important. And part of that stakeholders is also having like an advisory board, people that can help you in building your program, in helping to identify gaps and all of that. Another component is advocates.
Yes.
Advocates like folks from NAMI,
mm-hmm.
advocates from what we consider the peer community, people with that lived experience,
mm-hmm.
getting
yes.
their buy-in and having them to participate in CIT, not just in coming to present, but in developing it and helping to identify what is important, what is relevant for the folks that we are going to be addressing.
Right.
Mm-hmm. They have this, there's a phrase that came about in the 70s, nothing about us without us.
Mm-hmm.
So it's really important that we have folks with that lived experience at the table.
Yes.
When we're talking about that. And of course, another component is law enforcement. We need to have buy-in, and that was a key component, to have buy-in, to be able to identify resources in the community. That is
right.
huge. Because training is fine,
mm-hmm.
but what happens after the training,
mm-hmm.
and what benefit is the training, and how is it going to benefit the community? So those are some of the hallmarks or others of CIT. And one of the most important hallmarks with the initial CIT program was identifying individuals who could serve as that team.
Mm-hmm.
And so the initial thought for CIT was that those officers who identified to be on this team, there was a screening process that they went through. So it would be a specialized team, similar to SWAT.
Mm-hmm.
Is SWAT a
specialized
hostage
yes.
negotiation? So
mm-hmm.
it would be a specialized team
mm-hmm.
where field officers would identify someone who had a mental illness, call that team, and then that team would do the handoff.
Okay. Well, that's important. And even as you were talking about in Memphis, the training program that they had for law enforcement was like maximum 16 hours. But now the training that law enforcement officers go through CIT is a 40-hour curriculum?
Yes.
So what type of training or experiences will they get outside of the traditional lecture if they're going through this program?
Okay. So I'll first start by saying the Memphis model CIT program is 40 hours.
Okay.
There have since then been other programs
yes.
That are offered. The Memphis 40-hour is 40 continuous hours starting on Monday, ending on Friday.
Okay.
And depending on where you are in the country, sometimes they will have it where one day a week,
mm-hmm.
you know,
right.
whatever works in your
right.
community.
yes.
But
mm-hmm.
The Memphis model is 40 hours continuous starting on Monday, ending
mm-hmm.
on Friday. But again, it's more than just the training.
What else is it involving?
Well, it involves community input.
Mm-hmm.
It involves knowing what resources are there. It involves establishing collaborations, having those stakeholder meetings so
yes.
that you can discuss and triage some of the issues, the barriers, mm-hmm. the problems,
mm-hmm.
the individuals
yes.
in your community that are utilizing the system more than, you know, than others.
Right.
High utilizers, those
mm-hmm.
folks that are calling a lot, those folks who are really engaged, but also addressing some of those gaps
yes.
That we know that they're there.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And they're there in every community.
Mm-hmm.
And so addressing those gaps, identifying those folks who not just have an interest,
mm-hmm.
but folks who can get things done.
That's important.
Yes.
Yes, that's
folks
important.
Who can make those decisions. A lot of us are interested in this. But if you're not able to impact a change, it's good to have voices of advocates.
Right.
But you need those folks at the top. You need that buy-in from the top,
right.
whether it's in law enforcement or behavioral health community, legislators, quite honestly.
Yes.
You need that buy-in from the top to really make it happen.
Right. And it's also important, I believe, when you share in reference to the training
mm-hmm.
for the crisis intervention team,
mm-hmm.
that they have an opportunity of knowing the resources
mm-hmm.
and visiting the facilities so that
mm-hmm.
they know what services are provided for
mm-hmm.
Individuals in mental health illness or crisis. So
mm-hmm.
the officers are trained and experienced and
mm-hmm.
exposed to that.
Mm-hmm.
And that's very vital.
Absolutely.
So, yeah. So then even with CIT, is it a best practice?
It is a best practice. It took years to get to that point, but with the number of there's been extensive research on the CIT program.
Yes.
Two researchers that are near and dear to me, there are many,
mm-hmm.
But Dr. Amy Watson and Dr. Michael Compton both have served on the CIT International Advisory Board, and both are really, really great researchers
okay.
In the field.
Mm-hmm.
And so it is now a best practice program. But if I can, if you'd allow me to
talk
a little bit about some of the components that go into the training portion
sure, yes.
of CIT. So what is it? It is the training involves just kind of like a psych 101 kind of information to, we say it was for law enforcement, but quite honestly, any first responder can attend CIT classes, depending on where you are. So it involves just a basic understanding or just basic information about, let's say, about schizophrenia, about psychotic illnesses, about bipolar disorder. What is it? What did it used to be? It used to be called manic depressive illness, and some officers don't know that. We include, so there's also major depression. We include information on suicide. Suicide, second leading cause of death among our youth. It's certainly increased. We've seen a dramatic increase during COVID. We'll talk a little bit later about that. So we include autism, and but also Alzheimer's disease, also substance use disorder. So it's important to include all of those in there. So just some basic information, personality disorders, borderline, and personality disorders, and I can't think of all of them. But anyway, we talk about the personality disorders. Those illnesses that are more than likely when someone is in crisis with one of those are going to result in a first responder response. Not all illnesses will. So we talk about those. But some of the where the rubber really meets the road and where folks really get to understand the impact of mental illness on community, on individuals in the community, comes from that lived experience. Someone who has that diagnosis, who comes in and shares with that class what their lived experience has been. And sometimes it is just really eye-opening and jaw-dropping, some of the experiences we hear about in community. And oftentimes they talk about their experience in dealing with law
Law
enforcement,
enforcement.
what that was like for them. Sometimes it's negative, but more often it's a positive experience they've had. Oftentimes, that law enforcement encounter is the first time that they've been able to get connected to some services. So again, it's really critical to educate officers about what they see, and so they can be the catalyst, and oftentimes they're the first one to get someone connected to care or to get that family member to understand really what's going on. So we have that lived experience. And speaking of family members, we have family members like myself who come in and talk about our lived experience, how catastrophic it was. We had that those plans about what life is going to be like. We all do. You know, you have that baby and you raise that child and you have these grand expectations. They have their goals and expectations. And then, you know, you may get a scholarship to college. They may end up going to college. And then, boom, mental illness just rudely kicks in your door and sets up residence there. So they get to hear from us. What was that like? They get to hear not just about how the illness has impacted our family member, but how has it impacted us? We, just like some of the hallmarks of illness is isolation and separation. We isolate, we insulate, and oftentimes it's to protect that family member and the others that are involved in the family from what's happening on the outside, the things that people say, even other family members, you ought to do this, you ought to do that. And I say, okay, here are the keys. Come live here for a couple of days, you know,
And
or
then
see how
tell
you're
me
going to deal with it.
exactly,
So we get to share
exactly.
our lived experience. And another wonderful hallmark is being able to take that class to site visits. Sometimes we'll go to facilities where where officers will be able to take someone when they're in crisis, an emergency receiving facility, a stabilization unit, or peer support place where they can take someone who may be having a crisis. We would like to take them to facilities where there's a fast turnaround.
That's
Um,
important,
that
yes.
is very important. But also importantly, we want them to see people living in recovery. So we try to also include a place where they can go and talk to people who are living in recovery. They're going to see them at their worst when they're in crisis. We want them also to see them when they're in recovery and doing their best. And that is when sometimes that light comes
Comes
on.
on.
That is where the hope, we see the hope that this is what we're dealing with in crisis mode. But there is hope. People can and do recover.
Yes.
That have these diagnoses.
And the fact that you're talking about hope, that there is hope, mm-hmm. there is opportunities
Absolutely.
And possibilities. And that's
I wouldn't be here without it.
Indeed, indeed. And yes, yes. as you continue to share your story,
yes.
you know, you're able to share with us mm-hmm. how important it is and the hope that it is giving you.
Yeah.
Yes, I do still want to take an opportunity to our online audience. Feel free if you have questions for Pat to include them in the chat. Just put the name of the organization or agency that you're representing and ask your questions. As you can see, we're continuing to monitor the chat so that we can again present your questions to Pat. So please feel free to enjoy as well as engage in the conversation by offering chat, questions through our chat session. Pat, you actually alluded to COVID and talked about, COVID. I mm-hmm. would you, if you would share, how did COVID or still has COVID affected the CIT delivery?
Well, thank you for that. That is a really good question. Mm-hmm. And I'll say it's not just affected CIT delivery, mm-hmm. But it also has impacted how communities, our nation,
yes.
Views mm-hmm. mental illness. It kind of just lifted the veil, if you will, or just kind of took the scales off mm-hmm. and really allowed the public to see what advocates and those that work in the field have been seeing for decades. Mm-hmm. That mental illness
yes.
is real, mental health is
it's
real,
mm-hmm.
and it impacts
mm-hmm.
everybody.
Mm-hmm.
So COVID showed us that our children needed support, that their parents needed support, mm-hmm. that those who were considered essential workers, law enforcement,
yes.
other first
responders,
essential workers, mm-hmm. that it didn't matter that the rest of the community was isolated and had to stay at home. They couldn't.
They could not. Mm-hmm.
So the impact that it had on their mental health
right.
As well. So COVID really kind of not just lifted the veil for communities, mm-hmm. but now we have a national conversation. I mean, I used to pray for the day mm-hmm. that we would see commercials, that we would have celebrities,
yes.
that we would have legislators mm-hmm. all the way up to the president mm-hmm. talking about mental health. That day is here.
It is here.
That day
yes.
is here. So mm-hmm. we really need to capitalize on it and making sure that we
yes.
can not just take advantage of it, but that it's just not the flavor of the day.
Right.
Mental illness is
it's
not going
going away.
Anywhere.
Exactly.
And that said, I'd like mm-hmm. to just say something about the football game that mm-hmm. we saw this past
mm-hmm.
Monday.
Mm-hmm.
And how, for the first time in my recollection, the NFL just canceled and stopped a game
yes.
for the mental health of the players
yes.
on that field.
On that field.
That
mm-hmm.
was amazing.
Right.
Amazing. Would that have happened before COVID or without COVID? I don't know.
I don't know.
But it hadn't happened mm-hmm. before it.
You we're know, having a lot of persons say
yeah.
they've never experienced anything like that.
Yeah.
And so we know, even as we're talking today, it's still relevant in the
mm-hmm.
relevancy of crisis intervention teams, not
yeah.
just for law enforcement, but
mm-hmm.
for those who are not involved in law enforcement, but those who are impacted or interact with our
mm-hmm.
mental health in, industry, mental health communities,
yeah.
or mental health crisis, or just the mental health well-being
Absolutely.
For others.
Absolutely. And in Georgia, I can't speak for other states, but
mm-hmm.
in Georgia, we continued to teach CIT.
Mm-hmm.
So for the law enforcement instructors
mm-hmm.
that had to be in the classroom, you know, we took all the precautions, the CDC recommendations.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of our classes were canceled because
right.
of the outbreaks in different communities.
Mm-hmm.
But we still wanted to instruct.
Mm-hmm.
And so our clinicians, you know, their agencies were shut down. We allowed them to come in and teach virtually.
Right.
So we still had to go on.
Mm-hmm.
The site visits were a bit of a challenge, and even they were virtual.
Mm-hmm.
So they would take their iPads or other forms of electronic devices through the facilities
mm-hmm.
and share the facilities. And we would have sometimes an agency certified peer specialists
mm-hmm.
who are people that have mental illness that share their lived experience, but also mentor others, they would be able to share their lived experience virtually. So we're able to do that virtually and just pray for the day that we would be able to go live again.
Right.
We're there now.
We're there now.
Yes.
So the need is
yeah.
still there. And it was
oh,
great
absolutely.
That you all were able to
yeah.
transition with the times
yeah.
and still provide an opportunity for those who wanted the training to get the training
yeah.
and utilize technology.
Oh, yeah.
And so now we're able to even see, okay, we have all of these tools. Let's use them to provide and continue with the training.
Mm-hmm.
Can you share with us some of the benefits of a community-based this community-based program and partnerships? How does this benefit to CIT's benefit?
Well, let's talk first about the benefit to community.
Yes.
One of the benefits to community, and this one I think is primary and a primary benefit, it's for the community to recognize law enforcement as a part of the community, not apart
from the community.
The community.
Wow.
Mm-hmm. But it's also important for law enforcement to recognize that, mm-hmm. that they're a part of the community. They worship with us. Mm-hmm. We shop at the same places, send our kids to
yes.
the same schools, all mm-hmm. of that. So I think that is the first benefit of the community. Mm-hmm. To separate those barriers, there's a social distance that kind of exists mm-hmm. in a lot of communities between law enforcement and the rest of the community.
Right.
So it is reducing those barriers mm-hmm. and forming collaborations and partnerships with law enforcement, with advocates, with other folks in the community,
yes.
with the faith community, mm-hmm. with your local grocery store chain.
Mm-hmm.
With the mental health providers in the community, with your hospitals in the community. The list goes on and on and on. People with the lived experience. So it goes on and on and on about some of the benefits. Educating the community about resources.
Mm-hmm.
Because, you know, face it, there's one resource every community knows.
Mm-hmm. Go ahead.
911.
Yes.
We're going to
yes.
call that,
mm-hmm.
that
yes.
number. I did
mm-hmm.
because I didn't know what else to do.
Right.
Many of us in community, we're going to call that 911.
Right.
Now we have another resource,
mm-hmm.
988, to help address suicide and other behavioral health crises. That is another national number, doesn't replace the national suicide line, but it is another resource. So it's a whole lot easier in a crisis to remember 988 than it is seven or nine numbers.
Nine numbers,
that is really difficult.
Yes.
Even if you've committed to memory.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know about other folks, but when I'm in a crisis, this shuts down sometimes.
Mm-hmm.
So being able to have something, a quick number
yes.
to refer to is key. So informing communities about resources, informing officers about resources, because training them is great, but what do we do? What resources are available in the community?
Right.
If I could, just for a shameless plug.
Yes.
In Georgia, we developed this little pocket guide
yes.
here. That we have some tips about, because, you know, they go through the training, but then we have some tips about, you know, what some of the symptoms may look like.
Right.
But these pocket guides, we want officers to also share in community
mm-hmm.
so that they can be informed about the resources. It's not all, it's not extensive,
mm-hmm.
but it does give them a place to start
right.
in terms of identifying resources in the community, to reduce the reliance on 911,
right.
to be able to exhaust some of these other resources. But it also talks about some early onset symptoms.
Yes.
My kid,
mm-hmm.
I started seeing symptoms when she was a kid,
mm-hmm.
but I didn't know what they were because no one had told me. So it provides education to communities, those are benefits there,
mm-hmm.
To the community about mental illnesses, education to the community about what these symptoms look like, what resources are available, how to engage an officer, what to do when you have to call law enforcement for help. We provide those kind of tips in every community, and the officers themselves provide tips on. So if it, let's say the crisis has not risen to the degree where a law enforcement officer can intervene,
okay.
that officer can provide the family with some other resources that they can take advantage of. You know, to mediate those crises at home, get them connected to organizations
mm-hmm.
like NAMI, because
mm-hmm.
families need support too.
Yes.
Another benefit is a benefit to law enforcement and other first responders. So we started CIT in Georgia in 2004. And after doing several classes, it was clear that we were not just providing information and resources for those officers to deliver to the community,
okay.
but
yes.
we were
yes.
providing resources for those officers.
Yes.
They would come to us in confidence
mm-hmm.
and say, this is what I've been going through, or
mm-hmm.
following a critical incident,
mm-hmm.
I've been struggling with this, or this is, I have the family member
right.
that's going through something,
mm-hmm.
or I've been diagnosed and I just can't tell anyone.
Mm-hmm.
So they were able to share with us, and so we were able to, through CIT, to add a component in the Georgia CIT program. They've done this now nationwide in other
mm-hmm.
CIT programs, addressing officer related needs.
Yes.
And so again, I'd like to, if I could,
yes, you can.
Just take a minute,
yes, you can.
Because I'm all about resources, and just share a couple of resources with our viewers.
Yes, please feel
for,
free to talk
law
to
enforcement
our
and other
audience.
First responders.
Yes.
So, hi y'all. One of the resources that I'd like to share with y'all is called First Help. FirstHelp.org is the website, and they provide resources for all first responders. Blue help for law enforcement, red help for fire EMS, and I think it's yellow for dispatch, and then white for EMS. Mm-hmm. It is an amazing resource, not just for responders, but also for their families. One thing I love about them, especially with Blue Help, is in case of an in-line of duty death, even a suicide, they will send a care package to the family. And oftentimes following the memorial service, we go our separate ways. We may think about that family, but we're not as engaged. First Help, Blue Help maintains contact with that family. Another resource is the First Responder Support Network, FRSN.org. It is another fantastic resource for all first responders that they can get connected with. They have educational opportunities, all kind of great resources there for you and for your agency. And the last one is specifically for law enforcement. Again, there's others, many other resources, but I just wanted to share these three. COPLINE, COPLINE.org. COPLINE is staffed 24/7 by retired law enforcement who you can call them anytime and have a confidential conversation because they get what you're going through because they've been there and they've lived it and they've done that. So take advantage of, again, there are many others. NAMI has resources on their website. Seattle International has resources. IACP has resources. Mental Health America has resources. So take advantage of those resources so that, and I would advise, if you need them now, take advantage of them now. Mm-hmm. But if you don't, connect with them, see what they offer. So, because the best time to know about a resource and what they provide is before you need it.
Yes, indeed. Okay. Thank you so much for that information. I'm sure our audience appreciates it. To again, let them know and let each of us know about the additional resources mm-hmm. that are available and how to come about those resources. Mm-hmm. Again, just as we're talking back and forth with you, we want you to also feel free to add questions that you may have of Pat in our chat box. We are monitoring the chat and we will happily ask the questions that you may have for her. Now, when we look at nationwide, sometimes it becomes a financial issue of agencies being able to send officers mm-hmm. to CIT training. Mm-hmm. Are there additional trainings that may be available for someone who can't get to a CIT program?
Absolutely. And I would recommend just checking with your local area. Mm-hmm. NAMI offers some trainings
yes.
That are available to law enforcement. But the CIT International also mm-hmm. has additional trainings. They also have a conference annually, mm-hmm. and there are all kinds of wonderful workshops that are available that they give credit for
good.
To
yes.
officers and mm-hmm. folks that are attending. Professional credits for law enforcement and also for behavioral health providers. So that's one. Another one would be mental health first aid.
Okay.
Mental health first aid started in Australia. It is a wonderful training, but unlike CIT, it does provide an overview to instruct. They offer a class it's one for adults.
Okay.
They have one specifically for law enforcement, one for fire and EMS. Mm-hmm. And so it's just a kind of, what do I do in an emergency? And then, so they want you to respond as an emergency and then do the handoff to the appropriate professional
okay.
in
yes.
that way. So is that. There is a program that will help with learning about suicide prevention and intervention called ASSIST.
Okay.
It is wonderful. There is another one called...
Is ASSIST through the International Critical Incident Stress Foundation? ASSIST.
Yes.
Okay. That's another revenue. Yes.
That's one. And oh gosh, I said I wasn't going to forget this, but... it's not CPR, something, there's another training around suicide and it's just escaped my mind.
That's okay.
Okay. But it comes with information, but they also kind of give you a little kit there. It comes with a little brochure, a little workbook that you can have there. It will come to me. I cannot think of it.
While that one's waiting to come to you, I also want to talk about additional training that's available for officers or individuals, first responders that are not able to get to a CIT program. It's what we have at FLETC that's upcoming. Mm-hmm. It's our Mental Health Crisis Instructor Training Program. Mm-hmm. I'll share more information at the end of our presentation, but this program is also available on February 27th through March 2nd. And again, at the end, I will share additional information, but that's an opportunity for you if you would like additional training, additional information to go through that program. That program is designed to enhance the skills of law enforcement officers' response to individuals that they may encounter with mental illness, or they may be having a mental health crisis. What's important with that program is students are taught how to identify various mental health disorders, respond, and communication techniques, which of course we know is very important. We also talk about what law enforcement resources may be available. And so those resources we share nationwide. So whether you're in Georgia or a different state, we provide nationwide resources that are available for you. And then we make them available for you, at the individual as well as their agency. One thing that I do want to point out about CIT, the Crisis Intervention Teams training, as well as our Mental Health Instructor Crisis Instructor Training Program, is there's no diagnoses. We're not teaching anyone how to diagnose a disorder, correct?
Right, that is correct.
Yes.
That is the role of those who are trained in the profession,
yes.
Behavioral health specialists, behavioral health providers, psychiatrists, psychologists,
yes.
Social workers that are trained in that. What we want officers to do is just recognize behaviors as symptoms. And not just as behavior. Most of the time, the behaviors are going to be, different. They may be challenging. They may be even considered abhorrent.
Right.
But we want them not to think about a diagnosis, but look at those behaviors and to see that those behaviors may be indicative of someone having a mental health crisis.
Yes.
If I could say just something about the mental health crisis instructor training.
I was waiting to get to it.
Yes.
Let's talk about it. Yes, go right ahead.
I was able, fortunately, to go through that program.
Yes.
It was an honor. Mm-hmm. It was fantastic.
Yes.
Not only was there information about just a brief overview of the different illnesses and the resources, but we got an opportunity to interact and to meet folks from other disciplines.
Yes.
I came to the training as an advocate. There were providers there. There was folks there from fire and EMS.
Yes.
We had folks that were there from what we call a crisis response teams from those blended models of crisis response with law enforcement and providers. And
right.
of course, law enforcement was there. It was a phenomenal training.
Yes.
We got to do de-escalation training in the mock village,
yes.
which was just awesome.
Yes.
So I was a little disappointed that there wasn't any real coffee in the coffee shop.
No, there is not real coffee in the coffee shop. But
it looked real.
Yeah,
it was really, really lifelike.
Yes.
There were actors
yes.
who came in to help us with the role play.
Mm-hmm.
It was a phenomenal, phenomenal training, and actually borrowed some of the information to help us in our enhancing our CIT training program in Georgia.
Yes, that's
and making
good.
Scenarios realistic. It
so
was
we do
it
have that
was
scenario-based
really,
training.
It
yes.
was awesome.
Yes.
It was phenomenal.
I do want to address, we have some guests that are asking questions that I will take an opportunity to again, thank you for those questions. One question we have, Otis Luke asked, can the resources be posted? And even if we're not able to post them, we will make sure we provide them to you. All of the resources on the national level, as well as the Mental Health Crisis Instructor Training Program, we will make sure we have that information available to you. And then we have Jessica Bickery. Jessica would like to know, where can she get the pocket guide, as you talked about?
Okay, so this is for Georgia specifically. If you put your location and your email in the chat, I could send you the template. Again, these are Georgia resources, and you can kind of just modify it, for your needs and wherever your community is. But again, these are focused mostly on our state resources. What we encourage officers to do is to look in your community for additional resources. These are just mental health resources, but United Way is a resource, and there are others that we have not included in here, but do look in your community. Again, if you have, you send us your email, we'll make sure you get the template.
Yes. And also, we'll make sure that you have those the email address for Pat as well as for myself and for the Psychologically Speaking broadcast once we have completed the presentation. I do see that Gretchen Myers from Firestone asked, states, our area is working on a growing co-responder program.
Oh.
Is there any suggestions or topics on creating a joint training between the officers and their responders?
That is a fantastic question. And that is happening also nationwide. In Georgia last year, we passed Senate Bill 453, which would allow for co-responder teams to exist. Part of that bill also includes training for and cross-training between law enforcement and first responders. It also includes training for 911 operators, who are our first responders. And
yes.
So we are developing, have developed a program specifically for 911 operators. But it also includes self-help for them, too, because in a crisis, they oftentimes don't get to hear the resolution. And so they can be traumatized as well. So that program also includes tips and resources for those folks there. So I hope I answered the question.
Yes. Hopefully okay. That answered your question. And of course, Gretchen, if you need additional clarification, please, we are monitoring our chat. And so that we'll be able to ask so that she can ask offer additional or clarifying information. As you can see also in our chat box where you see Todd Rhodes. Todd Rhodes is our program coordinator for the Mental Health Crisis Instructor Training Program. And Todd is addressed in there that we will make sure we email to you all that resource list that we've talked about so that everyone in attendance will have that information. Additionally, Nicole said for the pocketbook for those in Savannah, Georgia, she provided the email address for getting that pocket book that, the, I'm sorry, the pocket resource that mm-hmm. Pat was talking about. And then Tammy states that she's in Georgia and that she'll look forward to getting that information. So I'm grateful to see all of the dialogue in mm-hmm. our chat box. As I'm continuing to go down it, I see that Amanda Bromer said that she can get the pocket guide to you all for those with in the Savannah, or excuse me, the Georgia area. And she's with the Savannah Police Department. Mm-hmm. Now, Daniel Nelson has a great question. And this is actually a great mm-hmm. segue to an upcoming program that you all have. Daniel Nelson asked, what about programs for corrections?
That's fantastic.
Thank you for that question.
Thank you for that question. Now, the Georgia CIT program does include models for correctional officers, whether it is in a municipality or state facility or even federal facilities. Mm-hmm. We do have some trainings involved in that. As a matter of fact, a new de-escalation model includes SIM munitions. And so officers who come from the correctional setting will be provided and is as a part of that de-escalation training, whatever type of equipment that they have in the correctional settings. We also have scenarios that are specific to that correctional environment. There is also a program, and I'm trying to I think it's the National Institute of Corrections
okay.
used to offer, they may still do it, a program specific. It's a CIT program for the correctional settings. So I think that's nic.gov.
Okay.
I think that's the correct website. So you may want to look at that for a program on the federal level. And that it's not offered only to federal officers, but any correctional setting. And I think there's an application process. At one time, it was a limited amount of folks that they would allow to a class, but it's a phenomenal training. But a lot of programs across the country also include information for correctional officers.
Okay.
All right.
And so hopefully that answers your question. Of course, Danielle, if you have follow-up question or clarifying question, please feel free. We are monitoring the chat. Also, I can see in the chat that you all are providing your email address. Thank you so very much for that because we will utilize that email address to make sure that we send you those resources that you're requesting and referring to. And so thank you very much. And as I stated, we'll continue to monitor the chat box and feel free to keep asking your questions. And so, but I do want to talk to you about are you aware of any statistical data that indicates the number of clients that are involuntarily committed versus those that are counseled on site and released?
I don't have that information. Mm-hmm. So the involuntary would be for an involuntary evaluation.
Okay.
And so thank you for that. So that there is some, because I used to think that that meant if taking someone involuntarily means that they're going to get some sort of treatment. That's not what that necessarily
right.
means. It means they're going to get an evaluation. And I think that's another thing that officers can share with family members when they encounter them on the scene, is that this is the process. This is how the process right. works. And if you wanted a longer stay, these are some of the things that you need to do to get your family member the treatment that they need. Mm-hmm. And so in terms of collecting data, in Georgia, we have what we call the behavioral health, BHL, behavioral health link,
okay.
and the Georgia Crisis and Access Line. They collect that kind of data.
Mm-hmm.
How many folks were triaged to an emergency receiving facility? How many were provided resources on site? But because of the confidentiality,
right.
mm-hmm. we cannot get all of that information. And so, but there are other areas, other states that do collect that data. That's why the stakeholder meetings are so critical,
right.
that you can get the numbers there. I personally don't have that information. We do have our CIT advisory board meetings quarterly.
Mm-hmm.
And so they tell us how many calls they received and how they were triaged. And so we can get that information without names, no confidential
right.
data. But we can get that. I don't have it right
okay.
now.
That's okay.
But it is accessible, and,
yes.
and hopefully in other communities it's accessible as well.
Okay, mm-hmm. that is great. One question I did want to ask are there some obstacles or roadblocks for CIT officers?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Let us talk about that for a little bit.
I think the biggest roadblock is infrastructure.
Okay.
So we can teach the team concept. Mm-hmm. We have providers coming in providing resources and information.
Okay.
But after the training, we have had officers email us,
mm-hmm.
tried it. It was really wonderful. It worked out just well. So, but sometimes they will say, I could not find a resource, because mm-hmm. a mental health crisis does not have a schedule.
Right.
It is not 8 to 5.
Mm-hmm.
And most crises oftentimes will happen after the facilities are closed.
Right.
So being able to connect that individual who needs services mm-hmm. to those services is key.
Right.
And
yes.
depending on where you are, of course, in some of our rural areas, the resources are limited. So it even takes them even longer. You may have an officer who will twice. Yeah, they may try it twice. They may languish in an emergency receiving facility, which just breaks my heart, for hours.
Mm-hmm.
And there are supervisors on the horn telling them, get back in service.
Yes.
And it's really difficult. So the next time they may just take them down and drop them off at the jail.
Mm-hmm. Instead of getting them
and tender some charge. Yes.
Send them for incarceration.
And again, that's why it's important for
yes.
those correctional officers on that receiving end to know
mm-hmm.
about mental illness as well.
Mm-hmm.
So the infrastructure, the lack of resources is one barrier. Another is stigma, quite frankly.
Yes, yes.
The stigma, not just of the community, but stigma in agencies who still sometimes see mental illness as a choice,
mm-hmm.
as, you know, behavior. It isn't to say that CIT is it's not a get out of jail free
right.
mm-hmm. Program. It's not, as some officers, you know, have the perception that it may be considered a hug a thug. It's none of that. It's about learning about resources. And so the stigma, and you know, another painful thing is having those officers get someone connected to a medical facility and that facility saying, we don't want them here.
Right.
Take them somewhere else. Or why don't you just take them to jail? So we not just see stigma sometimes for general community, but we also see stigma on the provider level, those that have taken an oath
mm-hmm.
to provide care.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Fortunately, in Georgia, we also have House Bill 1013 that passed that now requires them to treat mental illness on par with other physical illnesses, because
right.
it is a physical
illness.
It impacts
correct.
Your brain.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
So great. Thank you for sharing that. I see that Dr. Holler from Bethune-Cookman University has joined us, and he's actually providing some great information
mm-hmm.
regarding cultural competency. If you search for a Black mental health provider or are looking for Black experts or consultants, there are over 1,000 individuals in this directory that help provide the support that you are looking for. So in the chat box under Dr. Daniel Howler, please look at that link. Save that link to, again, be able to find an additional resource that's available for you that has Black experts or consultants, as well as for Black mental health providers. Thank you so much, Dr. Howler, for that valuable information.
I want
we
that
really
link.
Need that. Yes, we want that link. And so please, those of you who are currently on, you see that link, save it, and we will definitely make sure you get the link also for you.
Well, that reminds me
yes,
of another
please.
Resource. Oh, I know
course.
We have a
no,
lot to
go
still talk
right
about,
ahead.
But another really important thing, a group that we have not included, but we're starting to recognize are folks who may be deaf or hard of hearing.
Okay.
And so it's important that officers know that language proficiency includes those that are deaf and hard of hearing as well. So we have our language lines, but we need to make sure that under the ADA, which you're required to do, that we also connect with those resources, those interpreters, those qualified interpreters to help us address crises for folks in our community who may be deaf or hard of hearing.
Yes, thank you so very much. One last question that I want to ask, and again, for our listening and viewing audience, if you have questions, please put them in the chat. We'll make sure we cover your questions and provide the necessary answers for you. As it relates to any officer or agency that wants to start a CIT program in their area, can you provide information on how that can happen?
Okay. Thank you. I will really quick because I know we're getting short on time. The Mental Health Crisis Instructor Training Program is I will say that first. This
yes.
is a great place to start. Another one is CIT International. They have a train-the-trainer program that they offer annually. They also have a kind of a recertification program that they offer. So you can go there. CIT International has also, they have developed a guide on developing and starting a CIT program. Step by step, it takes you through on how to do that, who to connect with, how to identify the appropriate resources and the stakeholders in your community. And then almost wherever you are, if there is already an existing CIT program, again, CIT International is a great place to start to identify if there's a program in your community, just connecting with them.
Right.
Oftentimes, your agency may not have the infrastructure right now to do that, but you could sometimes partner with another agency like we did by going to Memphis to learn about CIT and to get started that way.
Okay, great. Thank you again, very, very helpful information. So if you're interested in a CIT program, starting a CIT program, or even getting additional information about the crisis intervention teams, again, we will send you the links, we'll send you the organizations, so that wherever you are across the country, you can link up with a national organization, you can link up with your state organizations or state agencies, so that again, you can do have the information necessary for you for this mental health crisis, mental health instructor program, and mental health services and resources that are available. Well, as we get ready to start winding down, this hour has gone by so fast.
Yes,
and
it
I know
has.
You may be looking and saying, wait, the hour's not over. It's not, but I do want to have an opportunity before we finish to share some valuable information with each of you all that will help us with what we're doing with Psychologically Speaking Broadcast, to provide you with updated information of things that we have coming on, as well as provide you an opportunity to tell us some specific topics that you are interested in. So please do not log off, do not sign off, because we don't want you to miss this valuable information. But first, I have to thank Pat Strode. You have been phenomenal. Thank you so very much for setting the bar, starting the standard, being our first presenter, and providing
honor.
Such valuable information on the relevance of crisis intervention teams in today's law enforcement. Thank you so very much.
Thank
we
you for having
you.
Me.
Yes.
I'm honored. Thank you. I'm very grateful.
Yes. Thank
you
very much. And so now to our audience, again, thank each of you for joining us today. Thank you for your valuable questions. Thank you also for giving us your email so that we can continue to communicate with you. We can continue to contact you, as well as send you the information that you've requested. So first, I want to talk about what's coming up. As I stated early, Psychologically Speaking is a monthly broadcast. This month, we talked about, of course, the relevance of crisis intervention teams in law enforcement. Next month, mark your calendars. You do not want to miss next month. Mark your calendars for Thursday, February 2nd, 2023, where we will actually be talking about involuntary treatment for mental illness. As you've joined us today, please share this information with those in your agency, your organization, or others that you believe will benefit from this valuable online continuous training that we provide. So if you have questions, if you would like to submit topics to us that you would like to see covered, on your screen, you see you can send information to us via email. You can send it to psychologically_speaking@fletsy.dhs.gov. And I see people are still, oh, thank you so much, Dr. Holler. I see you're looking forward to the next one, and you know we will be talking soon. So please email us if you have questions. Email us if you would like to submit information. Additionally, as I spoke to you earlier, if you would like to contact Pat Strode to talk more with her about CIT, to ask additional questions, or get clarification on any of the information we provided today, please contact Pat Strode. She's with the Georgia Public Safety Crisis Intervention Team, and she is a crisis intervention. She is our team advocate. Pat's information and email is there on your screen. Additionally, you have my information. I once again am Dr. Karen Ardwin. I'm your host, and that is my email address on your screen. Feel free to email me. You can email again if you want to talk to the group at the email address we provided earlier. Again, for what's coming up, let's talk about what's coming up because we want you to register. And if you haven't registered, there's still time. There are still seats available. Please register for our upcoming Mental Health Crisis Instructor Training Program. Register, register, register. How can you get information? Glad you asked. If you look on your screen, that next class for the class is coming up again, February 2nd through, as you were, February 27th through March 2nd. That's going to be our Mental Health Crisis Instructor Training Program. Those are the dates. If you would like to register for the program, it hasn't come on the slide, but it will be there. I'm giving you all of the information because it's important for you to join us. So for that Mental Health Crisis Instructor Training Program, you can get in contact with the program coordinator, Todd Rhodes. Todd Rhodes' email address is Todd, T-O-D-D, dot A, dot Rhodes, R-H-O-D-E-S, at fletsy.dhs.gov. And so before that screen comes up, you can also in the chat box send a message to Todd or post it for everyone so that he knows that you are interested in attending the Mental Health Crisis Instructor Training Program. Great training. We have an alumni right here sharing with you how important that training is. We do have limited seats, so we want you to make sure get registered, speak with your agency. And again, if you've already gone through that training, share the valuable experience that you had so that others can take an opportunity to receive that training. Again, our goal and our opportunity is looking for to provide additional training for all of you, whether first responders or those who serve in academia or whether you serve in the mental health community. Now, here's a great part where you again have an opportunity to be involved. Your input is valuable to us. Please do not log off and sign off without taking our survey. The importance of this survey, it takes only a couple of moments, but feedback is important. This will help us to ensure that the continuous conversations, our continuous learning meets your needs as well as we cover what we talk about as it relates to academic research, law enforcement data, and best practices. So please do not leave without taking the survey. Giving you all those couple of minutes to complete the survey. Again, thank you so much for being with us. Thank you so much for joining us, being interactive. Thank you once again, Pat. We value and appreciate all of your input, everything that you've shared with us. We'll continue to utilize that in our learning, in our professions, and where we work. So thank you again.
Well, thank you. And thank you, viewers, and thank you for your service to your community. We couldn't do it without you.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Yes. And once again, I have to take an opportunity to thank our division chief, Joe Aguirre, our branch chief, Walter Burns, our senior instructor, Todd Rhodes, to our instructors, Jeremy Turner, as well as Fred Acosta. Thank you. Special thanks to our entire IT team for all of that work that they have done. And thank you to our participants. Thank you for a Psychologically Speaking broadcast. We look forward to seeing you next month. Thank you.